Spirit come, come into our lives. From the beginning to the end, we'll be able to open our heart, open our eyes, open our ears to receive the wisdom from your word. Lord, just thank you for your presence with us from the beginning to the end. Pray in your son Jesus' name.
Amen.
So again, good morning, brothers and sisters. I'm really excited to be here to worship with all of you. And just before I go into the message today, I would have a quick question for you. Do you know the name of the person right next to you or in front of you or behind you? I think it's so important to know someone's name if you would like to get to know them better and to build a relationship with him or her. Wow, you guys are all getting excited with this movie. We're not going to show the movie today, but for those people you meet every day, I think, you know their names, but coming to church, some of us just meet once a week. So would you please introduce yourself to that person next to you or behind you or in front of you that you don't know, and just to get their name, quickly get their name. Since I'm a new pastor, new minister to this church, there are so many names I have to remember all at once. And there have been some embarrassing moments. Some of you introduced yourself to me already, but I still couldn't say your name the next time we met. I just really have to ask your name again and again. So please bear with me. But today, I would like to tell you that even though it takes time for your pastor, it's also known as your shepherd on this earth, to remember your name, that our Father in heaven, our God, knows your name already. So can you please turn to the friends you just met and say, God knows your name.
God knows your name. God knows your name.
You might want to ask, does God really know my name? What if I change to another name? Will God still know who I am? Or there are so many people having the same names, right? So can God really tell the difference? So when I was trying to remember all your names, I got a lot of help from people like Catherine, Joe, and some other guys. To differentiate Caleb with a C, Caleb with a K, or all these names. It wasn't an easy task, but I'm working on that. It can take a great effort to remember all of your names, but today I'm going to tell you, God knows your name. God knows your name. There are Bible characters who actually carry more than one name in their lives. Can you give me some examples?
Paul.
Let's take a look. So what was Peter's name before he became Peter the Rock?
Simon.
Yes, that's good. What about Paul? Father of multitudes, many nations. whole chapter 43 in the book of Isaiah is actually a prophecy and a promise to the Israelites that God will deliver them from captivity. It was clearly proclaimed by God because the passage we just read in verse 1, it begins with, "But now this says the Lord," or "This is what the Lord says." This is the word of the Lord Yahweh. And what did he say? What did he say? He said, "Do not fear, don't be afraid, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, and you are mine." Of course, in this context, God addressed Jacob, the father of the nation Israel, but in today's context, this is a proclamation to all of us. This past Friday, I really like the way Ning led the prayer time for us to pray for one another with the lyrics in the worship songs and scriptures by building up the name of the person you are praying for. So it's actually, the same thing when we read Bible. I always encourage people to put our own names into those verses when God speaks to someone. So when we read today's passage again now, can you please put your own name in the blank? Let's do it again. "But now, this is what the Lord says. He who created you, Jackie, and he who formed you, Jackie, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine." Yes, today I would like to focus on two things. I believe it will be beneficial for you to take away. And the first thing is, I want you to know that, knowing your value because God created you and formed you. We're all created by God, formed by God. Like King David wrote this in Psalm 139, saying, "For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works that I know very well." It is such a beautiful poem to show that David understands clearly how he is formed and made by God. David knows that God's words are wonderful, so his value is not determined by how many enemies he defeated or how much wealth he possessed. David knows that he is valuable simply because he's the work of God. In fact, we are all the same as David. We're all fearfully and wonderfully made. But still, a name can help us to identify someone or something. So when we talk about names, or especially some famous names of movie stars, musicians, athletes, or national heroes or leaders, even some well-known or popular brand names would pop up in our head, what would that be? Can you see some over here? Yeah, some, expensive handbags or watches and shoes, clothes, up there, cars. But why? Why are those things cost more than the other with a brand name? Why? I think, one of the biggest reasons is that the quality of design, materials and craftsmanship and the technology used on those products. And more importantly, it is because of the person or the company that made them. So we surely know that those names carry values. And some people will wear or use these products because they think, they will feel that, they are more valuable as putting those brand names on them. But special, you know, this book by Max Lucado. No one can put labels, either the star or the dot, on you if you know God is the maker. Even if you have a twin sister or brother, you know that there are still differences between you two, right? Because you are uniquely made. That's because you are the creation of God, and all of us are. We're fearfully and wonderfully made, and this is why we are valuable. More importantly, when God says, "I'm the Lord who created you, who formed you," God is also calling your name. So the second thing, I wanted to share with you is knowing God calls you by name for a purpose. The second part of today's passage, I think it says, "Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine." 2 weeks ago, again, we talked about it. This chapter, it's Isaiah 43. It was written in the time of a Babylonian captivity. So it was a time when the Israelites were suffering and struggling in the hand of Babylonians because they were captured in slavery and in a foreign land. Imagine that you're taken away from home and put in a place where you don't understand the language. On top of that, you are forced to do whatever the master commands you to do. All the labor work or dirty work the Babylonian didn't want it to. The Israelites had to serve them as a servant and slaves because they had lost their nation and couldn't return home. How miserable it is to be stuck in that kind of situation. It is a very sad consequence because the Israelites turned away from God, the Lord Yahweh, and started worshiping gods of the Gentiles. And it was a sin God could not tolerate. However, even in the midst of suffering, God sent Isaiah to tell them, "Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine." God called the name of Israel for a purpose because they are God's chosen people. God also called our names for a purpose because we are the children of God. In Isaiah 43:7, it says, "Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made." We are created for what reasons or a purpose? I think it says here very clearly, we're created for God's glory. If we keep reading the following verses in Isaiah 43, I think it's in verses 9. Verse 9 says, "Let them bring their witnesses to justify them, and let them hear and say, it is true. You are my witnesses, says the Lord, and my servant who I have chosen, so that you may know and believe me and understand that I am He. I am who I am." That's God's name. And in verse 12, again, he says, "I declare and save and proclaim when there was no strange God among you, and you are my witness." God knows your name, and God calls you by name for a purpose. It is very clear that God wants us to be His witnesses. So what does a witness mean? If it's a noun, it means a person who sees an event that takes place. And usually, it can be a crime scene or an accident. So when you see a car accident, the police will be looking for a witness who really saw it. But what does it mean to be God's witness? someone say, is God invisible? How can I see him? Or you probably remember that God told Moses, and no one shall see my face after, you know, he had this anger towards the rebellious Israelites because they built a golden calf. Have you ever prayed that God would work in your life and actually experience it? Have you ever had that kind of experience? Sometimes the prayer can be selfish or self-serving, but you might still see God's work, whether God answers you or not. In the Scratch Friday Night Fellowship, what does Scratch stand for? Student continually reaching and thirsting for Christ's holiness? Yeah, that's what I learned this Friday. all advisors thought, shared a testimony of one time how desperate he was to find a boy who got lost in the campsite. After searching for a long while in the dark, he almost gave up. But instead of giving up, he decided to kneel down and pray. It was just a miracle when Scott was praying and he heard God's still voice, and suddenly he found that boy was right in front of him. God knows our names and calls us by name for the purpose to be his glory and witness. So how do we do to be God's glory or witness? I believe it can be an occasion to share your own testimony, just like how Scott did with your friends and family. Or it can be an action you take to step out for a mission trip, you know, like Doris and Anson share their experience from their mission trips. Or it can be a decision you make to serve the people or the church. And it can be a willing heart to give back what you have received from God. I have a quick story to share. This is me, 11 years ago. I was on a mission trip back to Taiwan as well. And yeah, back in 2007, it was my first time going on to a mission trip, and we went to Puli. Do you know where it is? It's right in the center of Taiwan. And so, yeah, I went there to serve at an English camp, and I just found, wow, all these kids so adorable, and they were so active, and we were mingling with them. And one time when we were having a break, there were a bunch of kids just came up to us and asked, we know church is a nice place, but why do you only worship one God? There are so many gods in my house. You know, like those, yeah, idols in the traditional Taiwanese family, yeah, those local beliefs. And they will ask, yeah, if God is good, if God created the world and us, why there are still bad people? Still sad things happening? It was a tough question to answer, and those kind of theological things, I was hoping I can get something really, you know, like respond to them. So me and my teammates, we spent like hours that day just to explain how we believe in God, just one God, the source of life and the creator. But, you know, with our limited knowledge or experience or how our Christian, our maturity as a Christian, it was the only thing I could do. So we still played together games and singing and bingo, but after I left from the retreat, I didn't really know if I answered their question. 2 years later, I went on another mission trip, and this time it was more like a conference, because all the churches, EFC in Taiwan, they gather the younger people, the youth group, all together to participate this conference. And yeah, I was there the first day and tried to find my room. Finally, yeah, I got my keys and I was trying to open the door, and I heard people saying, "Jackie, Jackie, that's Jackie." I was like, wait, there shouldn't people knowing my name, because I haven't met my teammates yet. When I turn around and see, I saw the kids I spoke with 2 years ago from Huli. I was really, really surprised. They still recognized me and they still connected with church, because I really had no idea whether my answers satisfied them, you know, for their theological questions. And they came up to me and say, "Wow, so good to see you, and you lost your hair," because when the first time I went there, I had my hair down here. And so I was like, "Oh yeah, it's good to see you." And actually, when I saw them, I found my eyes wet, because it was an amazing moment, thinking, yeah, we sowed on the seed, but God has someone else to water them, to give them, yeah, you know, the sunlight or nutrition they need to grow their faith. And even 2 years later, they still connect with church and they came for the conference. And that was one of the, yeah, great reasons why God kept like calling me to missions and ministries. So if the good news, if gospel, if the salvation of God is in you, how are you going to respond to the calling of God? I believe this can be a question you want to keep asking yourself till you find the answer. So our Lord Jesus is our shepherd who guides us into the kingdom of heaven. In John 10, it talks about Jesus being the good shepherd who calls his own sheep by name. It says, "Very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate but climb in by another way is a thief and a bandit. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and lead them out." When Jesus calls us, we would like to follow him so we don't get lost or go astray. But of course, there are times in our life, probably just like the Israelites, human beings, you know, us also have this sinful nature to be rebellious. Recently, Yosef learned how to say no and buyao, buyao. And that irritates me a lot when we need to get things done. Or sometimes we just get lost in pursuing things that we think it's more valuable than the relationship with God. But today, I hope you are able to take away, yeah, these two things from my message. Oh, I skipped one. But knowing your value, because God created you and formed you. Everyone's uniquely made. Everyone has different talents, different calling. You don't have to be in a full-time ministry. If you are working as an accountant, do your work. If you are a doctor, do your work. If you are an engineer, do your work. If you are a student, do your work and fulfill the purpose God has in your life. The second is knowing God called you by name for a purpose. What is the purpose of your life? If you still cannot find it, maybe it's a lifelong question. You just want to keep asking yourself, keep locating yourself and making sure you're heading to the right direction. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for creating us and forming us with your mighty hands. Through the passage today, we know that we're invaluable because we are your work, your creation. You know our names, and you have called us by name for the purpose you have put in our life. Lord, give us courage so we can respond to your call in order to fulfill the purpose you've made us for your glory and to be your witness. Lord, listen to our prayers so that we can encounter your presence every single day. Lord, help us transform our thoughts into actions so that on the day you come again, we will be able to see our names written on the book of life. Lord, we thank you for saving us from our sins. And we pray in your Holy Son, Jesus' name. Amen. I would like to invite the ushers to come forward to collect the offerings. Yes, God knows our names. God knows our names. Let us bow our head and receive His blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up His countenance upon you.